This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. In this video, we're going to be looking at how our view of the atom has changed over time. While the atom itself has not changed, what we understand about it has changed a great deal. I want you to keep in mind that we still can't just look through a microscope and make general observations about an atom. Our observations about the atom are totally dependent on experimentation and how the atom interacts with other things. So as we go through this video, I'm going to mention the key people who have made major discoveries about the atom, and I'll talk a little bit about the experiment that they used to make those discoveries. The very first person to even mention the concept of the atom was a Greek philosopher named Democritus. He was born in 460 BC. He did not use any type of experiments. He was a philosopher who was trying to think about what was going on and trying to understand the world around him. Here's what he said. He said, matter is made up of atoms. Atoms are indestructible. They are solid but invisible. They are homogeneous, so they're the same throughout. Atoms differ in size, shape, mass, position, and arrangement. So he understood that the atom existed. He understood that the atom didn't change over time. He understood that the atoms of one element were different from the atoms of other elements, but he had no clue what the atom consisted of. We weren't quite there yet. He named the atom atomos, which was from the Greek word that means indivisible. Fast forward about 2,000 years, and suddenly you're not in the age of philosophy anymore, but you're in the age of science, where people are actually doing experiments and able to make real observations about the world around them. This brings us to John Dalton. John Dalton was an English scientist born in 1776 who is famous for his atomic theory. At this point in the world of chemistry, quite a few elements had been discovered, but not much was known about the details that made up the elements. John Dalton said this, "All elements are made up of atoms. Atoms of the same element are the same." So he meant that all of the gold atoms are the same. He said atoms of different elements are different. So a gold atom is different from a silver atom. He didn't understand what was different, but he knew there was something different about that atom. And he also said that atoms combine in small whole number ratios. So an example of this might be water, H2O. John Dalton was pointing out that there would be two hydrogen atoms for every one oxygen atom. That's a small whole number ratio. If you consider that these observations were made in the early 1800s with very limited technology, John Dalton did pretty well. We still agree that all elements are made up of atoms. When it comes to atoms of the same element being the same, I'll give them a sort of, because now we understand the concept of isotopes, but there are a lot of similarities between atoms of the same element. I do agree that atoms of different elements are different, and that atoms combine in small whole number ratios. So overall, John Dalton did pretty well with his atomic theory. Dalton's understanding of the atom in the early 1800s was a spherical mass where he really didn't understand what was going on inside of it. Let's keep going and see how this changed over time. In the mid-1800s, another English scientist named Sir Joseph John Thomson was born. He's often referred to as J.J. Thomson, and he is credited for discovering the electron. He used something called a cathode ray tube. A cathode ray tube has a positive charge at one end and a negative charge at another end. J.J. Thomson observed a lighted stream of particles going through this tube. He was observing electrons moving through the tube. He also noticed that if you brought a positive charge in, so you can see here there's a positive charge on this plate, it caused the stream to move towards it. If you brought a negative charge in, it caused the stream to move away from it. So J.J. Thomson discovered the electron and realized from this deflection that the electron had a negative charge. This was huge for the concept of the atom. Now we know that within the atom, there's something negative. So J.J. Thomson developed a new model of the atom that was called the Plum Pudding Model. The Plum Pudding Model of the atom said that the atom is still a sphere that is mostly positive with chunks of negative spread throughout. So at this point, he knew the electron existed, but he was a little off base on where it was located. He named it the Plum Pudding Model because plum pudding would have been a popular food during that time period, but you could think of it now as being like chocolate chip cookie dough, where you have your cookie dough here, this positive region, and then the chocolate chips are the negatives that are spread throughout. So the major change between Dalton's atom and Thomson's atom is now we know about the electrons. We know that within that atom, you have charges taking place. The next major development in the concept of the atom came from Ernest Rutherford. Rutherford was born in 1871 in New Zealand, and he is credited for the gold foil experiment. He used this experiment to discover the nucleus. The gold foil experiment used a very thin sheet of gold foil. So picture aluminum foil, but make it gold and make it much thinner. We're talking about just a few atoms thick. So here you have the gold foil in the center of the experiment. This represents a device that shoots alpha particles. And an alpha particle is a helium nucleus. It is a small, tiny particle that has a positive charge. So this device is shooting alpha particles at the gold foil, and you have a detector around the outside that is determining where the alpha particles land. Keep in mind, up until this point, Rutherford has J.J. Thomson's plum pudding model in mind. He thinks that the atom is a solid sphere of positive. So he's shooting these alpha particles. He's expecting them to kind of maybe get deflected a little bit, but mostly just to go through and hit the detector on the other side. What actually happened floored him. Most of the particles went straight through with no deflection whatsoever. They moved straight through as if they were moving through empty space. That in itself changes our understanding of the atom. Now, because of Rutherford's experiment, we can see that the atom is mostly empty space. The other thing that truly surprised him is that some of the particles hit something really solid and bounced straight back at the detector. They bounced back in such a way that it convinced Rutherford that they had hit something very small, very solid, and with a positive charge. Because you have positive charges moving this way, they hit something positive. Positive gets away from positive and causes it to bounce back. Rutherford was so surprised by this that his quote was, "It is almost as incredible as if you fired a 15-inch shell, which is a bullet, at a piece of tissue paper and it came back and hit you." So he was so surprised that it was as if he had fired a bullet at a Kleenex and it came back and hit him. This totally changed our understanding of the atom because now the atom is mostly empty space and it has this dense positive nucleus in the center. Rutherford's gold foil experiment convinced the scientific world that there were major problems with J.J. Thomson's plum pudding model, and it changed the atom to something more like this. This model of the atom is called the Planetary Model, and it is credited to Niels Bohr. He was a scientist born in Denmark around 1885. His model of the atom includes the nucleus, so I have a nucleus here, and then there are electrons moving in energy levels around the nucleus. So Bohr understood that the nucleus was present. He understood that the electrons were moving around that nucleus in different energy levels. Bohr's model of the atom is still widely used in the scientific community. You've likely drawn Bohr models before in a previous course. There are some issues with this model of the atom. So while it's still useful for understanding that electrons are in energy levels, it's not totally accurate because we now know that electrons are not moving in perfect little orbits around a nucleus. Which brings us to the quantum mechanical model, which is sometimes called the electron cloud model of the atom. This model no longer assumes that we know the exact path of the electron. Instead, this model uses mathematics and probability to predict the location of the electron. Scientists began to realize that even though the electron is extremely small, and even though it's moving extremely fast, it still follows the laws of physics. So scientists had to develop a model that followed the laws of physics. This model is a collaborative effort of many, many scientists. However, it is mostly attributed to two German scientists, Erwin Schrodinger and Werner Heisenberg. One of the big changes that came with the quantum mechanical model is the concept of wave patterns. Keep in mind that scientists had to edit the model of the atom to make it follow the laws of physics. So if you picture a sine wave, but make it three-dimensional, and make it go in a spherical shape around a nucleus, that is the mathematical model that scientists used to figure out the path of electrons or to figure out where electrons are located. That's what I've tried to indicate here with this circular sine wave that I've got drawn, and that's one of the many changes that came with the quantum mechanical model. Another big change that came with the quantum mechanical model is the idea that the energy of the electron is quantized. That means that it can only increase or decrease by specific amounts, and we call those amounts a quantum of energy. Think about when you're going upstairs. If you're going upstairs, you have to be located on a stair. You can be here or you can be here, but you can't be standing in between. If you apply that concept to the electron can be on this energy level or on this energy level, but not on an energy level somewhere in between. The energy of the electron is going to come and go in specific amounts. It's going to give off a chunk of energy or receive a chunk of energy, and that chunk is a specific size that we call a quantum of energy. And an application of that that we'll see later in this unit is that when the electron gives off that quantum of energy, sometimes that energy leaves in the form of light. So over the next couple of videos, we're going to see how energy levels and electrons are related to the atom giving off light. So hopefully you've seen that in just a few hundred years, we've made some major achievements in our understanding of the atom. It's gone from Dalton's atom, which was a very basic sphere, to understanding the energy of the electrons and understanding the different particles that are present and understanding that you have this dense positive nucleus in the center with mostly empty space around the outside. That concludes our brief overview of the history of the atom. Stick around as we learn to draw Bohr models, and then later as we look at how those Bohr models explain how atoms give off light.